So thank you so much for that introduction. I hope I don't disappoint you all in saying that I'm not going to talk very much about APIs. I'm going to talk about using technology to change the world. I'm going to tell you a couple of stories, starting with the time that I first went to Africa when I was 17. The poverty, the disease, and the lack of basic infrastructure like running water deeply shook me. But nothing was as devastating as the dramatic waste in human potential that I witnessed on a daily basis. I had traveled to Ghana as a volunteer to teach blind kids English, and I had expected to enlighten them to poetry and literature, to Langston Hughes and Emily Dickinson and the profound beauty of my mother tongue. And so I was shocked on my first day when one of my students, a skinny 11-year-old named Femi Abbas, told me that his favorite book was the Nigerian writer Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. He'd heard about it on BBC Radio and had found a Braille copy in the library. And yet Femi was so poor. His family lived on less than $3 a day. He was blind from a preventable condition that could have been averted had he drawn a different ticket in life's birth lottery. Living in that village in Ghana, I realized how arrogant I had been, and I learned what poverty really meant. When I heard statistics about the earnings of the poor, I used to think that they were out of context. $3 seems like nothing in New York City, but surely it buys a lot in a place like Ghana. But what few people know is that these figures are already adjusted for buying power, which means that 4 billion of our fellow human beings, 50%, more than half of humanity, rather, scratch out an existence each day on less than what the average American city would allow you to spend in 2005, or less than, sorry, what $3 would buy you in the average American city in 2005. So let that sink in for a second. $3 a day to support someone in the US in 2005. If you were Femi's mom, how would you survive on that? Would you spend it all on food for your family? Or would you let your other child go hungry so that you could afford to pay school fees for Femi? How would you cope with the knowledge that your son's disability could have been averted if only you'd had the money? This is a photo I took a few years ago in a mining town in northern India where thousands of men make their living by hauling coal on their heads out of mines and on bicycles, bicycling it to town and selling it for a profit of $2 a day. It's hard to believe that the same civilization that ended apartheid, mapped the human genome, and put a man on the moon forces a billion fellow humans into low-wage drudgery. The greatest measure of technological and social progress isn't how many billionaires we've created, but how we treat the billions of working poor at the bottom of the economic ladder. And the biggest barrier for these bottom billions is finding a way to earn a decent living. One-third of the global labor force, 976 million people, work full-time and earn less than $2 a day for their efforts. These are the rickshaw pullers, the vegetable stand owners, the coal miners, the manual laborers. A recent book by the polling company Gallup's chairman reports that more than peace, security, an end to terrorism, food, and even love, the majority of humans want one thing, and that's a good job. Work is at the core of human dignity. It's how we define ourselves. It's how we make a contribution in the world. And I believe it's also the best way that we can end poverty. So many problems, from sex trafficking to infant mortality, are rooted in lack of decent work. A living wage allows people to improve their condition on their own terms, to learn new skills, to better themselves, and to contribute meaningfully to their communities. A living wage transforms lives. And the best way to create living wages at the bottom of the pyramid is through the digital economy. We live in this dazzling new era of big data, right? The digital universe is something to behold. 1.8 trillion gigabytes in 500 quadrillion files, and more than doubling every 2 years. There are more bits of information in this digital universe than there are stars in the known physical universe. This presents a huge opportunity. The world of big data includes information like status updates and images, contact information for businesses, and a mind-boggling number of records. Machines can make sense of some of this information on their own, but what data scientists have found is that we need human judgments on a massive scale to find the signal and the noise. And what's remarkable is that we can capture human judgments with virtual supply chains, removing the constraint of physical infrastructure to create large numbers of jobs. The challenge with the traditional assembly line, which was the creator of millions of jobs in the last century, is that manufactured goods require expensive investment in good roads, in waterways, in reliable power systems. And most of this is simply not possible in the kinds of places where poor people live, in rural areas or in slums on the outskirts of the world's major cities. But what does exist in those places in great abundance is brain power. We've made massive gains in education to harness the brain power of the bottom of the pyramid. Global literacy has skyrocketed in our lifetimes. In Kenya, 95% of people under 30 can read and write in English. And thanks to Moore's Law, the cost of the laptops and computers required to get these newly literate people online is going down dramatically. Forget the $100 laptop. The Indian Education Ministry launched a $35 Android tablet. A credit card-sized computer called the Raspberry Pi launched in 2011 and sold out in 2 hours. It plugs into a TV and costs $25. These devices are connected in the most unlikely places. If anyone's curious, this is what the internet looks like, actually, in Africa. It's a spool of fiber optic cable. We took this picture about a month ago while I was in Uganda. And this cable stretches in one magnificent ribbon from the east coast of Kenya to northern Uganda. This cable has brought down the cost of getting online by 90%. So all of this led me to an epiphany 5 years ago when I met a young man in Kenya who ended up changing my life. His name was Steve Muthe. He was 25 at the time, he was my age, and he ran an internet cafe in Nairobi and told me a lot about the city's unemployment problem. The Kenyan elections in 2007 had resulted in mass riots on the streets, and I had thought that people were rioting because they were angry about the electoral process. Steve laughed. He said, "They're not angry, they're working." Many of the youth who filled the streets and the images on the news were paid $1 a day to riot. I saw in the alleys of Kenyan slums countless femmes who deserved better. I had just read Tom Friedman's book, The World is Flat, and I thought, if outsourcing was generating billions of dollars for a few entrepreneurs in India and China, why couldn't it generate a few dollars for billions of people in Africa and Asia and Latin America? Why couldn't we convert internet cafes like Steve's into digital factories in every village and slum in the world, fueled by work from large corporations sitting on enormous data budgets? And so, armed with this dream and about $10,000 in my life savings, I quit my job, I gave up my apartment in New York, and I launched a social business as a nonprofit called SamaSource for my friends Futon in Palo Alto. Sama means equal in Sanskrit, and our mission is to give work to those who need it most using the tools of the information age. We've invented a model that we call micro-work to transform this massive stream of data into jobs for some of the world's poorest people. Our homegrown technology, the Sama Hub, breaks down big data projects from large companies that include Walmart.com, LinkedIn, Google, and Getty Images. We break this work down into small tasks, and we train poor women and youth to complete these tasks from local computer centers. You can think of it as outsourcing 2.0, as both teaching a man to fish and ensuring that he doesn't end up living in a desert. Here's an example. A parking lot monitoring company came to us and said, "We can't train our software to determine whether there's a car in each of these parking spots." So SamaSource workers look at these images in real time and mark the spots with cars in them, and this is then used as training data. The applications of micro-work extend to every major company. SamaSource can mine sales leads from websites, can transcribe the handwritten records in every country's national archives, or add metadata to a huge video repository. Because we don't require a huge margin as a nonprofit, we can do the work that sits at the bottom of the outsourcing value chain, and that's increasingly common in the era of big data. Since we've started 5 years ago, we've moved 3,900 families out of poverty. That's 15,000 people, and they've stayed above the poverty line because of the skills they've learned through this work. And that's double the number that we reported at this time last year. When I first met Steve, he had 4 people working in this tiny internet cafe. Now he's employed more than 150. We now have 16 Steves around the world, and together we've shown that poor women and youth from slums and villages in places as diverse as East Africa, South Asia, and Haiti are capable of achieving their human potential through dignified work. One of these places is northern Uganda. I visited there last month, and this is where the cable has finally landed. Northern Uganda still bears the scars of a 2-decades-long civil war that saw tens of thousands of children abducted as child soldiers by Joseph Kony's infamous army. But now a different kind of war is unfolding there, and this is the battle for good jobs. In this region, unemployment can be up to 80% in some of the villages surrounding the main town among youth. Until recently, one of the unemployed people was Dennis. I met him inside his thatch-roofed mud hut, which he built himself from clay and from palm fronds from the surrounding forests. Dennis is industrious, but very poor. His earthly possessions include 5 chickens, a goat, a few pieces of clothing, and a hoe, which he's used to farm the land around his home and provide for his family for the last decade. Dennis, unfortunately, suffers from post-traumatic stress syndrome. At age 11, he was abducted by the Lord's Resistance Army and made to commit atrocities. Through incredible force of will, this man escaped to a survivor's camp, and after so many setbacks, at age 25, Dennis graduated from high school with a diploma. He was the first in his family to get past primary school. And then, like so many Ugandan youth who are educated, he got stuck. Dennis has no college degree, making him ineligible for any office jobs in the big capital city in Kampala. He got admitted to university, but he can't afford the school fees. There are no student loans in places like Uganda. So Dennis decided to take matters into his own hands. He started making bricks to earn a living, selling them for a few cents apiece to others in his village. He pinched every penny he possibly could, but he still couldn't afford tuition. It appeared that his fate was sealed. This bright young man would end up being a bricklayer. And then came the internet. Just a 5-minute walk from Dennis's hut, a new kind of work is taking root. Dennis lives in one of 100 villages scattered across northern Uganda that gets to experience the magic inside that red cable, which is broadcast across a 300-mile radius to shipping containers with solar panels on the roof. Inside, these panels power air conditioning and laptops for over 100 people who now complete work for tech companies, including Eventbrite and Getty Images. When I visited Dennis, he was tagging pictures of Andy Murray for Getty. Dennis started working with us a few months ago, and he told me he loves the work. He gets to learn computer skills, and he earns enough money to afford the school fees at the university. This container has become a lifeline to Dennis and so many others. It's like a well that allows these young people to tap into this mighty stream of work in the middle of a job desert. These experiments have brought hope to thousands of people as we've scaled in poor countries, and this year we decided we couldn't ignore the tragedy that was unfolding in our own. My home state of California now has the highest poverty rate in the nation. 22% of Californians live in families that earn less than $23,000 a year. Our level of income inequality in the United States today is higher than it has been since the 1920s. And I think digital work can help. So in March of this year, we launched Sama USA, which is a really cool program that's being piloted in the Bayview District of San Francisco that trains low-income community college students to earn extra income through online work. We teach people how to be web-based freelancers on websites like Odesk and Elance and even TaskRabbit, and we teach them how to market themselves and be prepared to work in the new economy. Again, we're seeing this river of digital work lifting the incomes of some of the most marginalized people in our own city. And we believe it could work all over the country. Sama Source and Sama USA are the first steps in a broader vision that I have. We're building a family of social businesses, the Sama Group, that all use technology and earned income models in new ways to address fundamental injustice around the world. The latest member of the group came out of a chance meeting with a retired Texan doctor in a small hospital in Sierra Leone. I was there in 2011 on a trip with the State Department to scout for Sama Source partners. But it was clear when I arrived that Sierra Leone, which is one of the poorest countries in the world, with a literacy rate of under 30%, wasn't a great fit for Sama Source. So I kept my eyes peeled for other ways to help. A few days in, we visited a hospital in the remote town of Bo and were greeted by local doctors. This hospital was destitute. The facility had 2 microscopes in the entire teaching wing. It was the only teaching hospital in the area. No consistent electricity and almost 0 infrastructure beyond beds and mosquito nets. As I was leaving, I overheard a thick Texan accent from down the hall, and I turned to see a really surprising figure in the middle of Sierra Leone, Dr. Darius Maggie, who's a retired OBGYN from Denison, Texas, and he was discussing birth injuries with some of his patients. Dr. Maggie told me that most women in his ward had been in labor for several days with no painkillers, and that their injuries had made them incontinent, unable to work, and isolated from their communities, compounding this horrible tragedy. He explained that today, 1 in 14 women in Sierra Leone die in childbirth, which is more than 100 times the rate in the developed world. This is a humanitarian crisis. 5 million women have died in the last decade in the simple act of giving life. I met a girl while I was there who narrowly escaped this fate. She was in Dr. Maggie's ward. Her name is Tiange, and she comes from a small village in northern Sierra Leone. She was a bright, pretty girl who excelled in English in school until after she turned age 12 when everything crumbled. She was raped by her teacher, became pregnant, and had to drop out of school. Making things even worse, Tiange endured a painful, prolonged labor that lasted 4 days and gave her a birth injury that made her incontinent. She had to retreat to her home in shame, where she suffered in silence for 4 years. Tiange suffered because she lacked a few hundred dollars to pay for a relatively simple treatment that would have fixed that wound. She's one of 2 billion people around the world that have no access to surgical care for easily treatable conditions like cleft palate or cataracts or third-degree burns. We have all of the money and know-how in the world to solve this problem, but most global health funding goes to prevention rather than treatment. And as a result, the bottom third of humanity receives only 3% of all surgeries. So before I left Sierra Leone, I had a crazy idea. Why not create a crowdfunding site for medical treatments like Kickstarter or Kiva? If we had such a site, then girls like Tiange would not be kept waiting for years for their surgeries. Femi, my young student back in Ghana, would never have gone blind. And the money could come from average people like you and me, who'd be attracted by the potential to donate to a website that was transparent and efficient. So I teamed up with two co-founders, and 6 months later, we launched a website called SamaHope. We allow anyone, anywhere, to fund a medical treatment for a person in need with just $20. Our goal is to fund 1 million treatments using social media and the power of the internet to link people to this critical need. Tiange, I'm happy to report, was one of the very first patients that got funded. After her surgery, she traveled back to her village, and she re-enrolled in school. Through SamaHope, thousands of people like you and me have come together to give Tiange and other women and children their lives back. These Sama ventures are still very young. The problems that we've chosen to tackle seem enormous and completely intractable. When things get tough and I feel defeated, I go back to the memory of my first days in Africa 13 years ago and to the relentless optimism of my young student, Femi Abbas. I remember the Femis of the world and the Dennises and the Tiangues and how they maintain hope even in the worst circumstances. The least that we can do is to follow along in their optimism, to decide to tackle poverty and the problems that stem from it with the same level of urgency and innovation that we applied to putting computers in every household, creating the electric car, and connecting 1 billion people to a social network. Technology can be a great leveler, but we must wield it well. We have to make a commitment to deploy technology as a powerful force, not just for social networks, but also for social justice. To apply our collective brain power to the world's messiest problems, which rarely surface in the beautiful conference centers, office buildings, homes, and neighborhoods that we occupy. And to call ourselves to put technology to its highest and best use as an engine of human empathy. Thanks.